Big shit. Name another podcast like this.
Check it. This is a Unique Hustle. It's your boy, ECEO, and I'm here with the lovely, amazing official, Miss Jamaica. What's going on?
Nothing. I'm a day walk on.
Man, I got a jewel in here today, y'all. Mm-hmm. Say, man, to be honest with you, man, ever since I started this platform, I knew that I was going to get this guy, man. We've been rocking in the street for years, man. I see him. I know he's a mover and a shaker, that's for sure, man, mm-hmm. for the city, man. My boy Gator Man is in the building, man. What's going on? My boy,
how you doing, man? How y'all doing?
Man, I'm so happy to have you on the show. You don't even know, man. You really a legend to me, bro, to be honest with you.
Say, man, it's all love, man. I appreciate that, bro, for real.
Man,
bro.
Hey, man, the city don't move, really, for me, unless I'm pretty much, if you're not in the scenario, it's a very slow movement for me. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, yeah. Like my history in the city of Dallas wouldn't be the same if it wasn't no Gator Main. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's what's up, man. That's what's up, man. Once again, it's all appreciated, but, you know, you just got to keep yourself relevant, you know?
Yeah.
It's a struggle every day out here.
Man,
in this world,
stop, man. Hey, man, did you ever think COVID would come? Think about that for a minute, man.
That shit was crazy, man. Nah, like, you know, we kind of downplayed it in the beginning, yeah. But, you know, and I think we all kind of got it in the beginning because, like, I got sick.
I know I got it.
They were like,
beginning.
I don't know what it is. They were like, I don't know. So
then Chamari and my daughter did the same thing.
Flued up and all that kind of shit, man. Keep it pushing.
And had to keep it pushing. Yeah. But then when you found out it was serious, I was taking about 5 showers a day. You remember that? I didn't know how to deal with it.
Man, really, man, it's really sad because a lot of people, they mental illness got worse.
Yeah, you know? Yeah.
So, and I dealt with that with my nephew. God rest his soul. We buried him not too long ago. But he passed from
COVID?
Well, no, he was paranoid schizophrenic. And then the pandemic set in and then depression and all that. And it kind of just took him. And, you know, we found him in DeSoto not too long ago. So it's serious, man. So right.
No, it's very serious. Like the mental illness is something that we cover on this show a lot. Like certain people that, whether it be them been through so much different things, abuse, domestic violence, or people that been through like dysfunctionalities in the family, that stuff, man, is things that we capture on Boss Talk.
And I've always been respectful of homeless people down on their luck and all that shit. But it gave me a newfound kind of, you know, you don't know nobody's situation, man. Could be drugs, couldn't be drugs. Could just, you know, somebody.
Yeah, yeah.
Right now.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
A lot of people love to hold things in, and they don't realize that talking about it is not that everybody know your business. You can just find one person to talk to, even if it's just a stranger, talk to them. Yeah, but you have to get it out.
I definitely think it ought to be more therapist set up in kind of the hood for like hood. Like, you know, as men, we talk to, suck that shit
don't
up.
Tell,
don't talk
don't,
about
yeah.
it. Don't nothing. You know what I'm saying? So it need to be people in place that they feel comfortable they can go.
A lot more of those places have been set up. A lot of people coming in, men coming in and saying, I am going counseling. I am seeking counseling. Some people, if they have insurance, because insurance covers it. But if you don't have insurance, you have a lot of people, because we've had counselors who've been on this show and talked about it. It's hey, you can hit us up on social media. We'll help you. We'll do it virtually, because COVID did help where you don't have to go to them anymore. They'll just do it virtually, stay home and just talk to somebody and just be able to deal with it that way.
Yeah, I've been seeing more kind of virtual therapist companies popping up too, like numbers to call and
the hustle real, Gator. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah, nigga, I've been seeing more shot boosts up. Everybody getting to it, man. The hustle is real.
Yeah, but what I like, man, they said in like the next 3 to 5 years it'll be the biggest money transfer, like as far as, you know, it ain't gonna be all predominantly white people rich, and that it's kind of spreading out, and you can kind of see it trickling down with, like, I got partners that's setting up logistics companies,
they ain't playing,
and it's thriving, you know what I'm saying? But another thing is social media. You're able to reach so many people.
Nigga, Country easy, Wayne, you know, see how Country Wayne eating niggas is eating. Yeah. Nigga, just take this and take that, nigga.
So it's still kind of level the playing field.
That very
but if
much
you're
so.
A person that love to invest or have money, you're trying to get ahead of the curve. You're not trying to see what's going on now. You're trying to look down the line and be like, okay, in the next 10 years, what's going to be booming? What everybody's going to be jumping on so I can invest on it now and wait, you know, to see my rewards come in by then.
Yeah. How y'all feel about the crypto world?
Everybody been coming at us about crypto. Everybody. And I don't know. I didn't ever get into it, to be honest with you, because it didn't anything that sound too good to be true, it be messing with me, bro. And honestly, like when you say I'm going to give you, you give me $10,000 in 3 weeks, you have $30,000. Don't do me like that, now, man.
Honestly, I feel like in the hood, if it's about stocks, crypto, or whatever, whenever we start knowing about it the most, it's the end of it.
It's over.
And niggas is really. Have you seen them play the card though? I'm talking about niggas come in here and, oh yeah, you know I'm in the crypto. I'll be like, nigga, okay.
Like, yeah, for real, man. No, it's just too iffy now.
I just really don't like when you tell me something, but it's like it don't make sense to me. Okay, you take the 10,000 and give me the 30 since you getting it like that.
Now, but if it take a crash, it's just the stock market. If it take a crash next week and it go down to nothing, like you, I'm just out of
you lost it.
But and it did that
lately too.
Nah. I still deal with this whole this currency.
I like to get out here. Hand to hand, nigga, a little bit.
But everything you do is a gamble, and it's like I just don't like to gamble.
Yeah,
that's the problem.
Oh, I can't tell when we in Vegas. Now don't do this.
I'm not a gambler either, man. I go down to the boat. I lose a couple of $100.
That's us.
No, I'm a secure gambler. Okay, that's what I call myself. I'm a secure gambler. I gamble with the house money, not my money. Okay.
Let's talk about Gator Man for a second, right? Let's get to it, man. Like, I
want to go back to because. Me from Jamaica, when I came, I found out about you from him. That's how I knew about you, man. Because he rapped the South like crazy. South music, Texas, all of that. So, but I don't know your background. I know your music because he plays your music. But I want to know, because that's how I end up falling in love with artists and your art. I need to know where you're from. I want to know how you were raised. I want to know your hard times, your good times. I want to know everything about you.
Well, man, it's a bunch of, more hard than good. It was a bunch of hard, but man, just raised from a
single parent home.
Yeah, pretty much. You know, my old man was around the city, but you know, Papa was a Rolling Stone, so he's doing his thing. But, my mother was a flight attendant, so she was gone all the time. So I was at my grandma and grandpa's house. And they lived in Highland Hills, so that's where I spent most of my time, and that's where I grew up.
But isn't Highland Hills like the rich area?
No.
She's talking about the total opposite.
You know what she's thinking about Highland Park?
If it's a totem pole, it's the opposite side.
You know when we get off, I had to explain it to her like this. You know when we get off over there off of Lancaster Road?
It's the edge of town.
And then we turn right and go down off in there, and we go to get the oils or something over in that area.
It's the questionable.
She don't know we even in the area when we in there. She from Jamaica, man.
Yeah, that's what's up, man.
But so Highland Hills, I would always hear you made me research Highland Hills. That's why,
man. You know, I got a partner named Kiki out the South. Man, he was like, man, when you dropped the walk the block. When you said Highland Hills, I ain't know nothing about it. It made me go ride through the apartments, go ride through the neighborhood, and that's a blessing, bro.
Like, So do you have any siblings?
Yeah, I have a sister.
A sister? So you the only boy?
I am.
How was that growing up, being the man, really, of the house? Because then your mom was gone, your daddy was hardly there.
Yeah.
So how was that growing up?
Well, like I say, my grandma and grandpa, they were like, and then like my aunts, I got a lot of cousins. We have a big family, so it was a village, you know, it was a village raised in Highland Hills. You know, it was old school. You know, you could stay out to 2, 3, 4 at night and nothing go on. You know,
okay. So were you a rebellious child?
Time. Huh?
Were you a rebellious child?
No, it's just being raised really kind of being around older people. They tend to just let you do what you want to do, so they kind of just let me loose. You know, I jump off the porch early, so
okay,
I had to go look at it.
So, when did you find your love for music?
Like I say, I'm older, so I've been around since hip-hop's been around. So I've been blessed. It's a blessing because I've been able to experience the East Coast side of it, the West Coast side of it, when the South, like, so I'm cultured enough to kind of been a student of it all, you know. So in doing that, it made me more versatile and more cultured in my music.
Okay. But when did you find the love? How old were you when you discovered?
I was probably about... You know what really, really turned me off was gangster rap turned me the fuck out, and you can just hear it in my music. Mm-hmm. So I think it was around the time Ice-T dropped at 6 in the morning.
Oh, okay.
So it was probably around the time it started getting bad, 84, 5, 6, you know, so.
Yeah. A lot of people use music as a therapy.
Yeah.
To let off what they how they feel inside. You know, we're talking about counseling and stuff like that. Some people use music as their counselor to get it off their chest.
But man, music is always been such an influence, and you really got to think about the powers that be that said, you know what, let's let gangster rap happen.
Yeah,
So, and then they had to know that that was going to happen.
But that's heavy, though, man. I don't know, y'all. It was super dope. The sound, the cadences, the way you guys was, the way it was coming. Yeah. And then you go back all the way back to, like, when you know me, I'm Eric B. and Rakim. The way they came straight at you with them lyrics. Not what everybody else was doing, but when them cadences were hitting like that, it made a nigga realize, oh, this is something different. And that was before the gangster, you know, the gangster rap movement a little bit, but it still has something in it that was a little more, to me, seasoned than what other niggas was doing. Am I right?
Yeah, especially if they implemented like the street shit or the real shit mixed with the lyricism, you know what I'm saying?
Correct.
Then it was like,
thinking of a master plan, ain't nothing but sweat inside my hands. When you hear that and you like, damn, you know what I'm saying, nigga broke. It really make you, it ain't gangster rap, but it's really talking about life scenarios.
Who's your favorite out right now?
Right, don't do that, man. Not up to the day. You coming all the way up. Out to the day? Man, that's hard, bro. I ain't gonna lie, man. Who I'm listening to right now, if I had to pick, I ain't gonna lie, and that's because I'm a street cat, and it's just me. LD300, the nigga that I've been listening to. Yeah. This nigga, the way he twisting and turning the words right now, I'm more to the streets, man. Like, somebody else would say Drake or somebody, but I'm telling you, I'm like, when you come out with something, I'm gonna cop that and listen to
man,
that.
Man, when I'm in album mode, I really force myself not to listen to nobody, because I don't want to subconsciously say or rap how they do. I kind of shut myself completely off when I'm in album mode and I'm trying to wrap up the project.
I'm going to be honest with you. I don't get tired of listening to Lil Kiki, you know, all the older cats. I ain't going to lie to you. I don't get tired of listening to the people who I listen to the road, you know, like, because that's an era that I got caught up in.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, I hear the new stuff that's going on. I hear the Gucci's. I just had my boy on here the other week. My boy, who I'm trying to think of? Which one of them did I have on here, babe? The rapping rappers, we have them all the time.
Yeah,
right, that's gonna miss you. Hot Boy West was one.
I was
of them.
Just gonna say, you
Hot
just
Boy
had
West,
the, you just
and who else? Who else was it? It's been a few of them. The new, like the new. Yeah. You got the CKOPs. You got the Smoothies. You got these are all the younger new cats. So I respect them for their era. You know what I'm saying? I don't try to be too judgmental because I remember where we came from.
Yeah, for sure.
I understand that there has to be a bridge there because. What you got to realize, and I know you probably already do, a lot of our people got locked up, man. It had a gap there. So I'm the forgiveness of that and trying to figure out a way to bridge those gaps. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
But I definitely can't get into something that I'm not really a part of. Yeah. You know, like, I can't do the dance. I tried to do a TikTok dance with these niggas, man. And she had me doing it. C4S, shout out C4S. Nigga, I hit that hole a little bit. But, nigga, I got stuck. You know what I'm saying?
Nah, I can't
them
do
niggas,
that.
Them niggas is, they doing their numbers. Some people getting numbers and that don't, what do you think about this, the way success equates to views and all that? Because you ain't in that world a lot because you try to stay away from it.
No, definitely. I'm not, I've always been one to kind of shy away from the camera and not been real like that. So, but what I like about it is, once again, it got everybody to where they can get some money, man. Like,
that's
if you're
dope.
Creative enough, back in the day, it would have been damn near trying to get an agent, go to Hollywood.
Yeah.
But when you were able to be creative enough yourself to make that many people follow you right quick and turn it into some money right quick, I applaud them, man.
Man, and it's a bag, too. It ain't no look bad. These niggas getting a big bag if they do it right.
But you know.
But it's work.
You know, like, what I like about the young niggas today is, they fuck with each other way stronger than we ever did back then. It was more competitive. It was gang shit. It was neighborhood shit. It was all that. When young niggas be rocking
with each other
and
more.
Spending with each other and, you know what I'm saying, and putting each other on.
No, you right.
They do that more, and you could tell because a lot of them get in the bag.
Yeah.
When it used to be just kind of a few niggas getting the bag.
No, you are absolutely correct,
so,
man.
So I like it, you know what I'm saying?
I like it too, man. I'm going to be real with you. I like the way that the money is, but that's because of rap. You got under rap broke bonds and broke chains where that was entrepreneurship game.
It infiltrated itself into every aspect of music.
100 and that's why I like it so much. So really, like I said, I applaud cats like you that basically. Think about Dallas, man. Dallas didn't really have no sound. Like, think about when you first started, bro.
Well, it was sporadic.
You had Nemesis and all of them.
You know what the Dallas sound is? It's the boogie movement. Really, it's the Dallas sound, bro. That's been the biggest sound to come out of here. Man, we got to be thankful for that era because them young niggas had the clubs, the city on fire, man. Everybody from the country coming down and. But they share that from, like you say, Nemesis, the Run C era, all that.
Snake, Island Boy.
That was a dancing count. The bass era was a kind of that Luke. It transferred over to that Luke era and Magic Mike and all that. So we've always shared that with Florida. The dancing.
Yeah.
So be proud of that.
No, you got to be proud of that.
Dallas is a dancing city, And like, man, they kind of been on that shit.
But not only are they a dancing city, but they basically... When you think about it, they pretty much permeated the world with that. When you think about it, bro. But a lot of people stole that style. I know niggas that came. Shout out Soulja Boy when you came down here. Y'all don't remember that.
Fucking with Rude and Rude Boss.
That's right. Because we knew we had something.
Well, Dallas been always such a huge market. You know, they come and feed off with.
And then take off. Yeah, because why do you think that it's so easy to do that here, though? That is sickening to me. I hate it, nigga.
You know what? Really, it's just a top market. Like it's a LA, it's a New York, it's an Atlanta market. So all big markets like that
don't
be decided by big corporation and big money. Like the smaller kind of markets, they don't really, you know. They'll give you a chance.
I gotta ask you about like the new era. When you say new era, we gotta talk about the Trap Boys, the Mo 3s, the Yellows, the way that era is. Even I seen Don Chief say something about a while back when he was on my show, you know, just about how that era was versus how it made the city look. When all of this stuff just transpired over a year and a half, 2 years ago, how do you feel like it affected the music game in the Dallas market?
Well, with me, man, it's kind of personal because as a rap nigga, you can't really have comments on other rap niggas. Me, personally, it's just kind of old school.
But...
I think it was the gift and the curse. It brought attention to the music. It brought, you know, the city was alive and, you know, kind of niggas was talking about it and all that, but it divided the shit out of it. You know what I'm saying?
And
when you pick a side, you can't get no money. You can't get no real life. Everybody got to be on the same page to get their money. But
it's crazy to me, but it's a real thing.
Yeah.
It's a real thing that everybody have to move different. I was just talking to a cat on here the other day, and I ain't gonna say his name, but you probably know him if I said him, but it's just like, hey man, it's serious, bro. Like, you can't move is out here dying. Yeah. Like, it's a hard thing to move after certain things happen in the city, bro.
But just as much as the city is quiet because there's really no conflict going on with the whole Mo 3 shit, it's still movement in the city beneath the surface. Because I done ran across, there's some little young niggas around here doing 1 million, 2, 3 million views on YouTube. You know what's going to lead to that after that.
Them niggas is going to be all right.
Like the little Tay Money chick. And,
she killing it.
And little Earl. Like Lil
killing Earl it. Another, he was like, just on here.
Yeah. So, like, you know, them niggas kind of making some noise.
I think they're going to blow. Yeah. And as they blow, it's going to change the algorithm of what we already experienced.
Yeah.
You see what I'm saying? It's going to make it to where it's going to be more where it's going to put our sight back on it again. In a way, but it ain't gonna be the same way.
Yeah,
and which is a good thing.
Man, out here in this shit, you just gotta fuck with who fuck with you.
You know what I'm saying?
It ain't really you gotta go after this demographic of people or go after that. You just gotta rock with who rock with you.
Man, hey man. So, I got to ask you about this song. You know, my favorite song you ever did was Kiss My Ass. You know what I'm saying? I mean, me and Lo Deezy sung that hoe on here together, nigga. Yeah, me and Lo, didn't we? Yes, we sung that hoe, nigga. And then I brought in a compilation, nigga, and it had that hoe in the background. That's how we started Boss Talk, nigga.
Yeah, for sure.
I want to ask you about the song because I never knew the history of it. I love the song. My first time hearing it, I was in the strip club, and them girls was playing. I don't know if you came in there or somebody, but that hoe hit the DJ booth and it was going down. It was at that strip club hard.
I was blessed to have some longevity with it, definitely, man. Yeah. To this day, you still, you know, it's one of them, they cut it on, people gonna react to it, you know. So, but me personally, I really don't fuck with it and don't like it much, man.
No,
it just represented me that was so long ago. So just imagine if you walk in the club every single time and they put that on and you done drop out 10, 12 mm-hmm. projects. It's like, no, but like, okay, I'm grateful, but nah,
come
y'all
on,
need to
man.
Hear this motherfucking no, this shit, it is crap.
So tell me though, how did you come up with that song and just give me the history on it?
Honestly, man, it's crazy because like me and Ice Fang, that's my boy, shout out Ice Fang, man.
Okay.
We both went to Wilma Hutchins and okay. all that kind of shit. So we were in the yo and we were like, it was around the time the Houston kind of era started getting big with the Autumn. And I wasn't a super duper big fan of that era because, like I say, I've been in every era down there. So
mm-hmm.
I came from more, I respect the lyricists. But it was just, we were fucking around. It was the very last song we put on the project. And that hoe, just people started fucking with it.
That hoe went in. So y'all didn't plan, was that the one that y'all spent off or was it another one that y'all was trying to push and that one just pushed
we
it out the way?
20-inch Daytons first.
I remember that one. And that one kind of just, bumped it.
Yeah, but both of them had good.
20-inch Dayton did his thing.
Yeah, but you got to keep in mind, it was in a time with no social media.
Nah, none of that.
So, like, mm-hmm. back then, if we wanted to get popping in Arkansas, we had to load that shit up.
You got to
go to fucking Arkansas.
Yeah.
But I miss that aspect of it.
I bet you do.
It's more hand-to-hand and you really feeling like, man, nah, I met that nigga. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
In comparison to just following
him. Yeah, it's a different feel. Yeah. Totally different feel, ain't it?
The ones who getting the real good money and the cult-like followings are doing both.
Yeah,
they're still
yeah.
going to them places. Okay, they rocking with me right here. I ain't got no shows here yet, but let me
get on
in
there and go down there.
Mm-hmm. Go through their malls. Let me
so
go.
Do you still keep in tapped in like that? Like, I'm going to go over here if I feel like that's where they rocking with me at? Are you able to?
With me, like, I really haven't dropped nothing new in Canada. So, like, I only do it after, you know, if I'm pushing a current project, I'll go move around. So
I'm
preparing myself to go do that. Like, I got a pretty good following in West Texas.
Okay, yeah, and West Texas. What part? Which one, Middleton or Lubbock?
Midland, Odessa, Amarillo.
Yeah.
Like, they kind of rock me up through there. And then in the Midwest, too. St. Louis and, you know, same places up there.
Whatever surprised you, like when, and I'm going to let you go because I seen you cock back. I seen you. But what surprised you in your career where somebody, it really messed you up that they felt this way or they seen you and they, you know, because you, I ain't gonna lie, when I see you, I be like, that nigga on the move. You know, I always just respected the grind, you know.
I don't know, man. Just like I say, just everybody know, like, being in the music industry, you have your highs and lows, and it'll build you up and break you down, build you up, break you down. So after a while, you find a balance, kind of getting numb to the bullshit. And, like, really, with me now, I'm kind of, the business of music kind of deterred me and made me be, man, fuck this shit.
Then
if I'm hustling in these streets and doing these numbers a day, and then that music ain't doing nothing.
All right, now.
So I'm hollering at them. Fuck that motherfucker.
Exactly.
Music.
I know. I seen you go through that.
But you shouldn't. Like, give that advice, like, don't just, you gotta. One still thing that I've constantly done, okay, I might not be dropping, I might not be active out there, but I write and record damn near every single day. Like,
I would think,
like,
that.
A lot of niggas that we knew from back then, they were dope dealers who rapped. They were an IT dude who just rapped.
Yeah.
No, I was a rap nigga who sold dope.
No,
I was a rap
know.
Nigga who pimped. I was a rap nigga who.
Yeah.
Like, so. Music that, like, I was, it was always rap first. So, like older niggas can't really, like, they get stuck in their ways, and yeah, you know, I'm still gonna sound like this when now you gotta stay a student of the game.
Man, I seen you.
You can't get stubborn. A lot of the big execs, when they didn't want to go over into the social media age and kind of really when it was everything was moving online, yeah, the ones that were stubborn lost their job.
Damn sure did.
Lost their companies, yeah, you know what,
yeah,
I'm saying?
Yeah, I'm gonna let you go because I know you got some.
No, what I was thinking about is when you were talking about, well, you jump in your car and go over here whenever you're trying to push something, but then a new generation right now is everything is social media.
Yeah,
it's not no hand to hand anymore.
Yeah.
So if a person is doing both compared to a person who has mastered social media and pushing it hard and really doing well on social media, which one earns more?
Definitely the social media, because they reaching.
No, man. But I'm talking compared to the person who's doing both, social media and hand to hand.
Oh, well, I guess when you get so big social media wise, it's going to lead to that answer. Because if you're getting hella offers in LA, you got to, hey, let's go. I really think they kind of hand in hand, but it's just the social media is leading to the road, and when it used to be the road would lead to your following, you know what I'm saying?
So yeah.
It's just, but like social media, like you could just reach too many people.
Yeah,
if you're savvy enough, you can reach so many
people.
Right.
Yeah, it's hard to beat it.
And then what I like about, like I say again about young niggas, is they controlling their merch. They controlling every aspect. When it used to be the company with them 360s and shit,
right,
taking all that, and they just making their show money. Now they making it all the way around, and it reflects. You can tell.
That's, and people knowing their rights more, so even when they're trying to make deals, yeah,
but you know what led to that? Like a lot of them old school niggas, blue niggas getting fucked. You know what I'm saying? A lot of them old rap niggas getting fucked, bad contracts. Mm-hmm. Like now, like they on game more now, and
people learn from other people's experiences, which is good. But what I wanted, because you say you're in the studio every single day, you always record all the time. So when are you putting out work?
I know, right? Like, that's my problem.
Yeah, like, because you do it. Are you romantic? You romantic? Where you hold on to it?
Yeah, the last thing I dropped was.
Was it that one?
Key to the City. I dropped Key
to the City. Was that the one with the Pimp C deal on there, or that was the one?
No,
I'm talking about? I'm talking about the one where you put that with that radio.
That was one all hell broke loose.
That was my one. I still got that one on this computer right now.
I've tried one after that called Key to the City.
That's the one I missed.
Where I'm at is just I don't really be dropping real consistently. I'll drop every couple of years, which you really can't do that. Like this day and age, you gotta. The new project is a lot of everything off of it. You know what I'm saying?
I'm getting down. I'm tapping. You gotta come on here when you get ready to drop it. You can't miss out on me.
So
you
when family is he gonna drop?
Whenever he to drop it, I just know he coming back on Boss Talk, nigga. Mm. And we finna let people know because we in the city acting bad right now.
June, July,
and we gonna be right back in this thing. You feel me? Because I just want to help, you know, promote and hell, we pushing, man. You know what I'm saying? Once I'm here, we got to take advantage of it. I think that's one of the big misconceptions. Like, man, it's opportunity out here, man, with this podcast world.
Man, with me, like, it seemed like whenever I say, man, fuck this music shit, and I'm like, man, fuck this shit.
It's in you,
somebody,
man.
Like, whenever I do that, I swear the next day I'll run into somebody. You Gator Man, save my boy. They go crazy, bro.
Yeah. So there's a lot of love out here for you. The same way.
Not Dallas UGK, nigga. Y'all got me bent, nigga.
Yeah.
I'm going to be out with you.
So whenever, I get that interest, say, fucking like,
bro,
happens to me, so I'm like,
you my top nigga from this city, man. Yeah.
I'm just so anxious for everybody to hear the new shit.
The top nigga for me in this city when it come down
to
I'm not playing, bro. So that underground thing, man. Like I don't even care. I know what I'm looking for, and that's just when I look now. You know I'm Pimp C. That we better get into that
number
too.
One.
If you've been watching this show, every nigga like we do. this is a foundational bill.
Yeah, man. Rest you know what I'm saying? Rest in peace to the Pimp, man.
So how did you guys come out with that since the 90s, man? What was that about?
Well, actually, man, Pimp had came down and he had did a verse for me. I think it was right after he had got out of jail.
Okay.
I think the first time, I think. But he came down and he did the verse for me, so we developed that relationship. And then I got a relationship with Jay Prince.
Yeah, I know.
And Big E, so it all kind of intertwined to where I kind of was working with him on that. But we didn't actually put the song together till after he passed. So okay. It was Jay kind of gathering up music and yeah. kind of adding stuff. So
you and Pimp talked and you
yeah, hung yeah, out with, yeah, yeah.
Well, give me a Pimp C story. I'm going to do just like I did Mike Jones and everybody else, nigga. You ain't going to get out of here without giving me a Pimp C story.
You know what? I don't really
met that day, nigga, he wiped his eye and...
You know what? I don't really have like a one where he kind of spazzed out.
No, I wasn't spazzed out.
I wasn't fortunate
enough. You ain't that type dude, though.
But I wasn't fortunate enough to just spend a whole hell of a lot of time with him, even though I respected him. And he is Texas, you know what I'm saying? But when he did come through, he came through for the verse. He was on his business. He did this. And he hugged the nigga. Hey, bro, I appreciate you. You know,
yeah.
my hard-earned money. So, you know, that mutual respect was there. So whenever he came to town after that, we would rock.
I'd come
to his shows. But it really wasn't I didn't spend too much. You know,
no, it was business. You paid your bill. But y'all knew y'all was connected to some of the same people.
Yeah.
Okay, and that brings up another point. Like, just you and the Rap-A-Lot thing. It was a time when you came out with some music, I want to say, and it seemed like you had signed with Rap-A-Lot or something. What was the deal with that?
Well, once again, me kind of doing that... Pimp C song when they were working on that project, it just led to Jay Prince fucking with me. You know, I've been blessed to sit down with Jay Prince. You know, gave a nigga a lot of game, but he just, like, from there, he fucked with a nigga, so he put me on the compilation where they redid a lot of songs, and, you know, he kind of put me in a position, put me on songs with Wayne and Luda and Chris Brown.
Wayne,
Luda, and Trey Songz.
Really?
Yeah, but it was all on that compilation.
Yeah,
so, man, that was a blessing for him to do that, you know.
You didn't even know it was going to happen, or how did it transpire?
No. He was like, they were in the process, you know, send me music, and I was dealing with a International Red. Shout out to Red. So, yeah, man, we were just putting that shit together and sending the music, and they were fucking with the verses, so they were using them. So,
yeah,
I was grateful for that.
When you did that, when you were dealing with the Rap-A-Lot, when I knew you were dealing with Jay Prince, I was like, man, damn, my boy, he gone now. You know, in my mind, that's my gone moment. You know what I'm saying? Like, damn, that nigga doing his thing. Because it seemed like you got more aggressive during that time with your music.
Yeah.
Am I right?
Yeah, but I just... chose and decided to just stay independent. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
You know, when you've been a boss for so long, not dealing with no music shit, it's hard to kind of
wander
a wing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
How's that though? Do a Jay Prince or something? Do they respect that? Look like they would respect that more.
Yeah. Come on, when you real niggas and stiff, you know, it's so beyond the music. You know, so on the different business aspects that everybody got going on. So
yeah,
and all about music. So.
Yeah, yeah. So, what about you and Bun B? Did you ever link up with Bun?
Yeah, man. Bun had me. He had me on this project. I'd have been on like got me on like two or three things, man. And then up and coming, I got some brewing. Probably that Sip Drink Music Part 2 to where I'm gonna be working with him. So me and Bun and I always had that mutual respect, man. Bun is a stand up
man. He been posting, you know, Boss Talk. Shout out to Bun B. He been posting that. Boss Talk.
Definitely a stand up dude, man, and he's respected all over the country for being that way, man.
Man, I just had Bobo Luciani on here, man.
Bobo.
Man, me and Bobo kicked it, boy. Hey, man, we went for hours in there. She was over there like this, nigga. Nigga, we've been sitting this all night.
Now, that's who got the Pimp C story.
Man, that nigga went off. Nigga, we was in there. She was over there like this, Gator.
I was not.
Man, that nigga was doing like me and you doing now. Yeah. She was like, then she'll get back into it. Then, but it was tough. It wasn't easy. So let me ask you, man. So Facts of Life, man, one of my favorite songs. What caused you to write that? And how did you come? I'm going to ask you something else in a minute. But that Facts of Life, let me know what made you come up with
it.
It was
I had heard the beat. That wasn't the original beat. I think I just heard the beat somewhere. And so I was just going through a lot. You know, all that shit that I was talking about.
Man.
I was kind of going through it anyway. So give them facts, you know. So it turned out to be a good wrestler, like kind of like one of my personal facts.
I like it, man. I loved it at the time, and I was at the strip club when I heard it, nigga.
Motherfucking strip club.
We was in them things back in the day,
man,
boy.
They was in them.
I can't even remember how many times, man. I couldn't count it. I was in that thing every night.
Man, it was so crazy, man. Me and one of my partners, man, we were hitting day shift and night shift. Like, we got hard 1 year, bro. Man, look, we pulled up to DG's. It had to be about, you know, we out there, but it had to be like, if the club opened at 10, I think, We had that bitch like 9:45. Like, come on, bro. It's ridiculous. Like, they ain't even dressing out yet, y'all. So, look, we go in there, and we sit down, and, you know, it started kind of getting thick and shit, and the fucking ATF hit that bitch. Boom. Oh, boy. I used to, like, man, they hit it so hard. When they cut the lights on, all you saw was just little packs of where niggas was going, and they probably dumped
it. Get rid of it.
I was like, bro. I said, nah, this enough, bro. Nigga need strip club or Dynamus or something, bro. Like, nah, bro. We is not, like, we this early in the morning, bro. Like,
man, that's the way it be addiction, because you be like, it's a hangout.
Yeah,
what's and that? It's like, yeah, everybody there, you know, it's easy. And usually the laws ain't tripping. They usually ain't tripping. They trip every now and then, but not like, you know, like consistently trip. So
man, another time, like, we had, we were in California. And we had got like 2 pints of some drink. So we couldn't take it back on the airplane with us. So we just had to finish the whole 2 pints. And we had like a red eye flight that next morning about 5 or 6 o'clock. So we drunk probably 1.5 of them whole pints. Man, we so sleepy, bro, like ridiculously sleepy. We in the airport. Just snoring, bro. Like, we stressed out. They coming like pushing her like, hey, y'all gotta. We got on the airport. We was in on that. Like, they were waking us up, bro. So, look, I don't know why I thought just that little bit of sleep on the airplane was enough rest for now. But, like, I hadn't been in the city in probably about 2 weeks. Like, I was in D.C. and some other shit. So, when I got back to the city, I'm like, hell no, I'm crunk. That was enough rest. I'm in the city. Man, I went out that night. I think I went to, what's the one that used to be behind DG's?
That was at one time. It's been they called it. It's bro. Been a lot it's of things. Everything. It's been the, what they call that thing? Damn.
I don't know what it was at the time, but I was at that club.
It wasn't, I thought it was PT's.
I'm drinking Patron. I done drunk probably about 8 Patrons, no sleep, been on there drunk.
Onyx, that's what it was.
Bro, I blacked the fuck out. Like, they say I ran up in the dressing room, because I was like, they say, like, I done muffed some bitch. Bro, the security guard said, bro, when I came and found you, like, it was like you had some West Dallas partners in there. It was like 7 of them, and they were huddled around, and you kneel down in between them. Like, you said, the security guard just patted me like the Red Sea, like, bro, come on, get the fuck out. And then they never just used to kick me out, because I used to be raised there. They'd just be like, bro, you can't come back for a week.
Bro,
you can't come back for 2 weeks.
Bro, you was in that thing. I ain't gonna lie. When I knew I was gonna see you somewhere, when I hit the strip club, I'm like, oh, Gator gonna be here. Or bro, if I left, seen you, yeah. it didn't surprise
man,
me.
Man, I left there. Like, I was in my home, and my partner was following me. He was begging me not to drive. He was like, bro.
Don't drive.
Like, he said, man, I was doing about 150 in the Hummer. We went to Ecstasy. Now, we ain't go there. We went to Tigers. They say I got into it with my ex, and... Like, so we fighting in that hole. They kicked me out of there. And then, like, I'm on my way to North Dallas. He said I was just scraping the side of the hallway with the Hummer. He's like, bro, I thought you were going to flip it, bro.
You, so he all was in there with you.
All I, no, he was behind,
he behind you.
Yeah, I'm like, all I know is when I woke up, my truck was parked in a skinny head park, but it was parked neatly in there. Both of my right and left tire was on flat. Like, I mean, both of my right side tires was on flat. The whole side of it was scraped up. And like,
you don't remember nothing.
It was like a big ass like gash in the rim to where the dude like, man, I don't even see how it's holding air. Like, you done like chipped like
damn.
A big ass. Like, just think if that shit would have flipped doing that fast. And
boy,
that,
like, hey, boy, God was on your side, bro.
That was God, man.
That was God on your side.
A lot of instances like that, it was just God, bro.
Yeah, 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 man.
That homo would have got the flip and I'd been out there. Probably had no seatbelt.
Boy, I know you was wilding out. Because we used to wild out. Young nigga wilding out. What? So, when you dealt, how did you get E-40 on that song on that since the 90s? I got to ask you that.
Well, once again, that was put together with Jay.
With Jay. So, he the one made that one. Okay. All right. Because I just trying to figure that. I knew you said Jay put together. I was just like, E-40 always hollow clip. Yeah. I done heard that nigga hollow clip a lot of times.
Go Hard Black is his first cousin.
That's what it is.
He got that. You know,
that's why I asked that, because I know he kind of, he be screaming that old Cliff thing. You know what I'm saying?
Shout out to E, shout out to Go Hard, man.
Yeah. What do you know, you be watching, little Ty Harris was on here, man.
Man, I like Ty Harris.
Yeah, that
man.
Nigga a musician, man.
Yeah, I like him, bro.
That nigga
like
was on
him.
Here. That nigga love that piano, man.
What made me a fan is Voices.
Voices.
That song, he got Voices, where he had the alternate ego.
Yeah.
In the video. To where, like, after that, his creativity and, once again, being able to play.
Yeah,
As he's talented, bro. I like him.
Yeah, that's...
Is he still with Cube?
I don't know. He mentioned Crabtree when he was on here.
Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
but he,
so him and Michael.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
I know.
They went to school together.
Yeah. He definitely mentioned him on here. Yeah. Did he mention anybody? I think that was it. I know he, him and Bobby Billions real tight.
They
real tight.
Oh yeah,
you know they got a song called Blood Brothers.
Yeah,
yeah.
And it go hard too.
Yeah. Bobby Billions doing this thing too.
Man, I heard him.
He's got that plaque.
And you know what? That boy got that plaque, man, and you can't take that from him.
No.
You can't take that from him. Niggas be talking, but a lot of niggas can't talk that talk. And I say this, and I say it when you ain't on here, but I'm gonna say it, man. When you look at these artists down here, they don't get the shine because they ain't from New York and all that. We got to give them their shine ourselves, because
well, you know what the streets is gonna say is, could the record have been that big?
They always do that, man.
That's what I say.
You know, that record couldn't have
been, and it don't fucking matter.
Mm-hmm. It don't matter, really. Like, come on, man. Like the city should be really applauding the song anyway, because it's ours. Yeah. Okay, Dallas got an opportunity to say, hey, man,
it don't matter. But my personal opinion, no. It still wouldn't have been that big.
I agree 100%. I agree 100%.
You know, Three just put that shit on there, but made you think it was heels, boy.
But
like, if you didn't know no better, just listen to that song, don't know nothing about it. You think that was
Let me ask you this. Do you think if he'd have been living, it would have went did as good?
No. Well, you know, I think it still would have been big, but I think for the sake of the record, they would have got together and they would have worked.
I don't know. Because I just know when Three were living, he always was in that kitchen. He got a lot going on.
Yeah.
The three I know or seen, because I didn't never meet him, but the one I seen, he ain't have a lot of time for
But if that record would have started just getting bigger,
he would have went with it.
He would have went with it. Because that's how them Atlanta niggas do. They don't even really be rocking with each other in person. But if they got a record together, they going to show up to their club, be on opposite sides of the club, go on stage, do their record, and when it's over, go back to their sides and go on about their business. Like, for the sake of the record,
How do you like the way Dallas is so far as the way the music is, the separation and all that, and how it's the state it's in today? You just said something. Atlanta can do that. Do you think that we can ever get to that point?
I think we all right, man. It's just it is a separation, like I say, that Three and Yella and Fred and shit. It definitely divided the city, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, it divided the city, but I don't know, man. I just think the city evolves and is growing, and it's going to always be, you know, kind of other shit going on, and shit, you just got to see where it go.
And what about the bloggers? You like the blogging that's going on? That's a new thing. Yeah, they the new stars, nigga. I'm taking pictures with people, Gator. Yeah. Gator. When I walk out, they take a picture with me now.
I done had my issues with some bloggers here and there, but that's only because it wasn't good journalism.
Okay.
That's only because it was plagiarism. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, yeah.
So, like, nah, if it's it respecting your craft and how with longevity, and you know, say with me, I used to trust people way too early, but now, like with me, like nah, I gotta do a full ground back.
I
gotta see how you are for at least by 6 months to a year. And if you start moving goofy, or if you start doing weird shit, or being and crying on social media and all that shit, nah, you ain't still fuck you.
Yeah, so, and that's real, because you got a lot of people that just pull up to the city. Like being honest with you, me being from somewhere, but I've been here longer than most of these niggas been living. So at the end of the day, I went to Players Club, niggas. I went to, you know what I'm saying, Lakeside and RJ by the lake, nigga. I was with Scarface in that hole, so I can talk this talk, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, I've been here longer than most niggas been living. So at the end of the day, but when you look at the city, I just say, you know, we got opportunity, man.
Dallas is just,
we got opportunity, bro.
It's its own monster, man. But like, you can't really, like, what I don't like is niggas from the city that talk shit about the city.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck Dallas.
You must hate a lot of niggas because they be doing that.
Yeah, but you steady in here in this motherfucker. Man, okay, Dallas might be a little fucked up, but it's how we motherfucking got. So we finna ride this motherfucker, and we finna still try to get it and figure it out. We're gonna be dirty, clean, we're gonna do it all, you know what I'm saying?
So yeah.
It ain't no fuck the city. Hey, you mean, what kind of weird ass shit is that?
Nah, you can't do that.
As much as the Cowboys piss me off every fucking
boys,
season,
with boys.
Ain't no fuck the Cowboys. Don't say no fuck the Cowboys, you know what I'm saying?
Oh, look.
I can
a
say
Jamaican
it.
A Jamaican hater right here. She ain't trying to hear it, man. She's just mad because she ain't never seen her do the Super Bowl.
What is her team?
She don't have no team, really. She just, because we in Dallas.
In our defense.
The Patriots.
That's just because they won all them years. Y'all niggas.
In our defense, a Dallas Cowboy fan can turn a person out. Like, we are.
We don't care.
I just can't understand why everybody, even if you're not from Dallas, it's all about the Cowboys.
It's America's team. It's America's team.
What made them the America's team?
It's the Dallas Cowboys.
That's Dallas. What made them America's team?
You see how Gator got up? Nigga, it's America's team.
I don't even know how to, like, it's
yeah,
just.
Yeah, like,
it's,
what made them America's team? There's so many other teams in America. What made them America's team?
It's that star. It's that blue and white.
It is what it is.
It's Roger Staubach. It's Dorsett. It's like, it's so many greats over the years that's done. Over the years, decades ago. Yeah.
You can't take them five rings away. You know what I'm saying? You can't take them rings away.
You know
away.
What? We're going through a rough patch, but we're going to figure that shit out. But I'm the same way.
Because the thing is that I loved the Cowboys in the beginning, but I was tired of being let down. So many times they get all the way up to the playoffs, and it's like that year looked like the year.
I said, man, I ain't fucking with them bitches until they won a second playoff game.
Let me tell you something.
They got won a second playoff
game. DeRoe came over on here, man. You should have seen the look in his eyes, man. One day he was up with Jamie Foxx and all of them. I seen him. I said, boy, that nigga having a good time at the playoff game. That nigga coming here with his head down, man. I didn't know if we could go do this damn interview. I said, DeRoe, man. Man, you know, man. I say, hey, man, we gotta get this. That nigga hurt, boy. Listen, it wasn't he hurt. That's the way it be, man. Because your heart is into this stuff, man. You know. So, what else you got for Gator, man? I tell you what, you got what we got for.
Yeah.
But hey, Gator, man, come on, man.
Okay, first I'm going
to
do this.
Gator, man. No, wait a minute. Don't give it to him yet, man.
And it's crazy because it was around the time I was fucking with it. We were playing with it, but. Then shortly after that, I didn't produce no more beats.
Are you serious? You produced that yourself?
I did the beat, bro. And then after
that baseline?
And that's one of my regrets is I should have kept doing beats.
You killed it.
Yeah, I should have kept doing beats.
That drop.
Because that's where the real money at. In verses, they going to get verses every now and then.
Man, that drop in that song, bro. Yeah. Come on, man.
But then I just said, fuck that shit.
But it's not
what did you use to make the beat?
I really, like, it was around the time where it was one of them times where I just said, fuck music, period. I'm finna go trap. Like, I was just like, fuck this shit. So, I should have kept doing beats.
Man.
But it's never too late. You can still do it now, can't you?
I just don't have a desire to do
man,
it.
Man, that nigga, man, that beat, the drop on that beat. It was the that drop.
Yeah, I was like, yeah. It was a cool, man. I think my favorite song on that project was Ball of Fall or the D-Town Roll Call, I think.
Oh, yeah, the D-Town Roll Call. Well, you know, you had so, man, I could listen to the whole thing. I was kicking it, bro. Like, we had CDs back then.
Man, around the time I was working on that project, I was doing it half here, and I was up in, I did another part of it at Death Row.
Really?
Yeah, back then. And she was crazy. So, like, yeah, I was, you know, kind of fucking with Death Row around that time.
It's funny you said that Snoop done acquired something. Yeah, I don't know what Snoop got.
He got the company, but he didn't get the publishing.
I figured he wouldn't.
But not for the number I heard.
But he still to have it back in his grasp, and he can bring out music, and he can rep that brand like that.
The bar gonna be set hella high compared to that other shit, but it's still a beautiful thing.
You think you're gonna be all right with it?
Yeah.
You gonna be all right?
Yeah.
That's Snoop, huh?
Because you got to think in mind what he finna make of merchandise. Just think he still got the ability, all that artwork and the doggy style cover jackets. And so now he can do that with them box. And he finna be all right.
Why do you think they love Snoop so much on the West Coast? And here, everywhere.
You know why? Because he just one of them niggas, bro. He's just a real, he just, you know, he's just a cool nigga, bro. Like, He just that high, just OG nigga that ain't like, who, man, who's Snoop finna be with, bro? Like, he's just too respected, bro.
He's kicking it now.
Everywhere. He's so respected everywhere to where you can't. If you ain't fucking with Snoop, you just a hate man, nigga.
You can't get around Snoop, right?
Come on, bro. You got a problem with Snoop.
You can't get around Snoop, man. Well, come on, baby. I'm sorry. I went back in the mode. I went back in the interview mode. Go ahead.
Okay. So, we'd like to present you with this.
Uh-oh, I got some goodies.
You got to get the boss talk.
I got some goodies.
You here, nigga. You family now. Say, you been, man. Hey, man. The boss talk 101. Come on, man. Stop playing, man.
Say, that's love for real.
Say, man. That hoodie, man. Listen, man. We come through with the hoodie, nigga.
That is love.
They in trouble, man.
Yeah. I got to.
You know what I'm saying? Ain't nobody. Hey, listen. Everybody be calling me for these dang things, man. They like, man, I gotta have one. I'm like, nigga, they just love the the movement, man.
Yeah, I do.
The movement is real, man. And I thank you for coming on the show.
Man, I appreciate y'all for having me.
Man, come on, man. And we got something else for you, too.
Yes, we do. That's not the only goodie you getting.
Oh, man.
Yeah, we ain't playing no games,
man. It's my birthday today.
We ain't playing no games, man.
It's my birthday, man.
You know what I'm saying? We'd like to present you with an award.
Oh, yeah, man. We ain't playing.
That's love, man.
Man, we ain't playing. That's why I had to get, nigga, look, I ain't playing, nigga. In the city, we got to show our people love and give them roses while they're here, bro.
That is what's up.
I'm promising you that. And I don't know where else, whatever platform you've been on, big ups to them. But we here now, and we going to love, nigga, till we get out of here.
Say, that's what's up.
You know what I'm saying? Period.
That's what's up for real.
So the award says presented to Gator Man, a.k.a. Kenneth Piper, in recognition of a legendary music career with Southern roots.
Yeah, for sure.
Keeping the heat in the streets and creating a foundation for the next generation.
Man.
Come on, man.
2022,
man.
Yeah, I appreciate
real
that.
Real talk, man. Say, man, appreciate you, man.
For real.
That thing serious, man. Like I said, man.
That's on my mantle right there.
I think, like I said, our thing was when we came into the game, we not going to get in front of the people that we, you know, cover for in this city and not show love. You know what I'm saying?
Sure.
Because at the end of the day, you take the time out, you come over and see us, man, and you guys done put in so much work, and I feel like the recognition don't be there a lot of times.
Yeah,
so it's like, man, I can make a difference. So me and my brother was talking, and I was like, man, you know what? My brother was like, man, you need to give them awards. I'm like, man, you know what? Nigga, when we do this podcast, we giving out awards.
Yeah,
we
man,
blessing the city to the ones you know, who paved the way.
That smile act of kindness, man, go real.
And if I can sleep at night, and I did it right. So, you know what I'm saying? I can go home and like, damn, man, I got to meet Gator Man up at the spot. He came through. We wasn't at the strip club. We was at the spot. You know what I'm saying? And I got to bless him, man. I don't do nothing else. I did that.
Man.
You know what I'm saying? So
man,
thank you,
love,
man.
I appreciate the both of y'all for having me.
Man,
sure.
Come on, man. And like I said, when the new project come out, man, make sure you come through, you know what I'm saying?
Sure,
I'm going to listen to that thing, too. You know, I put this music on, nigga. I be in here just vibing out. And then, you know.
Yeah, I want to sit with you, man. We go down through that thing, man. You check it out.
Yeah,
man.
Because what I want to do is, like, people do listening parties and all that, but I'd rather get it from you just narrating. Then when we put it out, before the project come out, people get to hear your perspective on it. And like you said, this internet thing is dope. It goes, it transcends, it's everywhere.
Yeah.
So,
like, worldwide plays, man, it's crazy because I got a good following in Austria and like different places like that, and it makes
mess
you like,
your head up,
it makes you really want to like, damn, why does that particular reason like my shit?
It's crazy though. Like we get when we go live, it'd be like, man, we in Africa, we love you. I'm like, what the hell, we getting in Africa? This is crazy.
I'm telling you, social media don't make
it's
the
crazy.
World so much smaller.
It did, didn't it, man?
Reach those people
for sure
because music has transcend culture because people just love music. They don't care where you're from. A lot of time people are like, I didn't know you from Dallas or that y'all located in Dallas because it's a social media.
What'll mess me up is when you'll see a little girl from like a third world country hit Beyonce better than Beyonce.
Oh,
can't even speak
hard.
A lick of English.
Go eat.
That's amazing.
You know
that
happens, bro.
It's amazing to me how European artists sound so soulful and then talk like a certain way.
Yeah.
They start singing. They sound like us.
Mm-hmm. Let me ask you this, man. Top three artists of all time. You're not getting out of here without
that.
Everybody answer that.
Any genre.
Everybody answer that. Top three artists of all time.
Golly, man.
Dead or alive, any genre. That's our top three segment. Number one
is going to have to be Pimp C.
Hey, God dang it, man. You know what I do, Cash, when they do that. This one step is on down, nigga. We'll shut it down, nigga.
Yeah,
no. Now, how you feel that?
Number one, gotta be. It's, and you know what? And you getting this from somebody like, once again, I like more lyrical. I come from the lyrical era, but the feeling he gave me over a fucking decade was, man, like, I couldn't put in KRS-One and get ready to go and hit that club.
No.
I gotta put that dinosaur up against that Woo! Wood on and go hit that thing. So the feeling he gave Texas, and man, we lost a legend.
Man, we lost a hell of a
legend.
That would
be my number one.
Number two.
Tupac Shakur.
Yeah, Tupac Day One.
He was at
Tupac like, Day One.
It was just his versatility. Like, he could drop, when he dropped Me Against the World, it was different. Then the next one, and the next one, and the next one, and McAvey, like every one of them was just so, it just was so orchestrated and fit a mood.
What about
so,
that? Only God can judge.
Yeah, all that, man. So he probably definitely have to be Tupac.
Yeah, number three. That's always the one. That got KLC, you know, yeah, KLC. Yeah, I stopped. He had a whole list and couldn't figure out that number three. Man, I had on list
it's
five.
So hard, man. Cause that when you say the three, it's just gonna disrespect
you.
4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, man. You're
number three, man. The last God one. Who made the list? It could change, but number three today for Gator Man.
The Gator Man. Shit, I'm sick as nigga around this motherfucker, man. I'm the illest nigga in the motherfucking city.
Boy, I love it.
I'm the illest nigga. I'm the illest nigga in this motherfucking city, man. Yeah, like that thing.
And y'all better respect that. The man said what he said, and he stand on that. You know what I mean? Take it, man. Hey, man. Thank you for coming on the show. We love you, Gator Man. And if there's ever anything you need, Boss Talk 101, we are out.
For sure, man. And I appreciate y'all.
Definitely, man. Hey, man, it's been another great segment of Boss Talk 101.
And we out. So, Gator Man, this award is presented from Boss Talk 101. It says, presented to Gator Man, a.k.a. Mr. Kenneth Piper, in recognition of a legendary music career with Southern roots. Yeah. Keeping the heat in the streets and creating a foundation for the next generation to come.
That's what's up, man. I appreciate y'all for real, man. I appreciate y'all
man.
So
appreciate
much,
man.
My
boy, hey, man, come on, man. We giving up roses while you're here, bro.
Yeah, man, for sure, man.
For sure. Appreciate it. Holla at your boy, man.